tradition of music gazing. I'm here with Clare Longendyke, who is playing the Chopin Piano Concerto No. 1 in E minor with the Arlington Philharmonic tomorrow. And she has agreed to answer a couple of questions that I have about what it is to be a concert pianist nowadays, the preparation that it takes for this piece, the rehearsal process, etc. So thank you very much for being here.
It's
really appreciate
pleasure.
It.
Thank you for having me.
We are really happy and we want to congratulate you again on winning our concerto competition, which is the reason why you're here today. And I wanted to ask you, how does one person start playing piano as a child and become such a virtuoso as you are today?
That's a great question. When I started when I was 7, so which is considered pretty late, actually, as far as pianists go. And my path was a little bit unique, and I always say that it was very American. And the reason I say that is that I studied in France for a couple years, so I had the cultural comparison to make. But I loved the piano, but I had a teacher who let me play whatever I want to. And as a 7 to around 12-year-old, what I really loved was Disney. So the first 6 years of my life, I was playing Beauty and the Beast and The Lion King and Cinderella and Snow White and all the greatest Disney hits. And while sometimes I look back on that and I say, look at all that time that I lost, what a shame, I think the way that that transformed in me as a current player now is that, first of all, I didn't quit. I never quit because I could sit down at the piano and play music that interested me and that I loved. And the other thing is that it developed in me a sense of musicality, which every time I play for people, they say is my sort of my great characteristic, is that I'm very musical. Not to say that I necessarily lack in other things, but audiences react particularly to my ability to communicate through music. And it's something I pride myself on, and I think it owes a lot to sort of the popular background in music that I have.
When you auditioned for this competition, you only had 15 minutes to prove yourself among other candidates. And I know that many other competitions are the same. So how do you prepare to take on demonstrating all the abilities you have in such a short amount of time?
Great question. Actually, I had 12 minutes. And the reason I remember that is that I had the advantage of the piece that I played, which was the Schumann Concerto, was one of the selected pieces that my university, Indiana University, chose as the departmental concerto competitions for that semester. And so I was learning the piece anyways, but it was to my benefit to compete in that competition as well. And at IU, the way that they divvy up the piece, because there were 14 pianists auditioning and they don't want to keep the faculty there for too long, is that they give pre-decided cuts. And those cuts were 14 minutes. And so I was already a little bit in the mindset. I had gotten into the routine of practicing for a while, sort of splices of the piece. However, the difference was that they cut out the second movement completely. Mm. And for me in that piece, for people that know the piece, it's got these two enormous first and third movements that are extremely technically taxing and very showy. And then they have the second movement, which for me, whenever I'm listening to a recording, I jump to the second movement of the Schumann, because it's so hard to interpret, and it's like chamber music with the orchestra. I mean, it's constantly in dialogue. The piano says one thing and the orchestra responds. So the recordings and the interpretations that I prefer are the ones where the pianist really communicates their idea very, very tenderly and with conviction. And so when I was deciding my cuts, I said, okay, well, the one thing I need to do is absolutely to put some of the second movement, because that's where you hear the lyricism and the sort of back and forth, the ability to play with an ensemble. And beyond that, it was just sort of making sure, it was a lot of practicing the 12 minutes to make sure that everything was smooth, that I could sort of change hats from one movement to the next without the built-in transitions that Schumann writes. And that just took rehearsing with a fantastic collaborator to whom I was extremely grateful that she was willing to sort of go over it with me over and over and over. And it also took knowing the piece very well. And that's the way I approach every piece that I play, whether it's with orchestra or on my own or with another instrument, is that if it comes to a point where I can't do that, then I don't know it well enough, and it's back to the drawing board, back to the score, back to the practice room. So
I'm assuming that a pianist of your level has to have a very rigorous practice regime in order to keep up your technique. So what is a standard day in your life like?
My life is still a little bit hectic because I'm in the last year of my doctoral coursework at Indiana University, so I have a lot to balance. I'm also an adjunct lecturer in piano at a small college in Indiana, so I've got teaching at both schools, classes, and practicing to balance, which is always a little tricky. And real life, I mean, you know, I have cats to feed and humans to feed and things like that. Part of what works for me is that I'm extremely disciplined about my day. I plan out my entire week the weekend before, and I set goals for myself in terms of practice time. And you know, going back into the competitive thing with other musicians, I'm also very competitive with myself. So I really push myself to, and sometimes, you know, other musicians are probably listening to this thinking that's not a great way to practice, but I really push myself to meet the time goals for practice that I set for myself, because it's about quality practice, but if you don't get enough quality practice in, then, you know, it doesn't feel like enough. You don't feel like you've had time to really touch everything. And I'm the kind of person that feels like, especially in a piece before a performance like this, I have to touch every note every day. Especially as it's getting time to perform. So my days are all a little bit different. Mondays, for example, I teach one class that's 50 minutes at IU and I'm done. So generally I practice between 4 and 6 hours if my brain can, and my hands can generally handle it. If my brain can handle it, sometimes I get a little tired. And I should also say that of all of those things, even my coursework, don't tell my teachers, practicing is always my priority. I will always say, I will wake up at 7 o'clock tomorrow morning and finish this reading for this course if it means getting another hour and a half of practice in. So I'm really a performer before I'm an academic in many respects. But other days of the week, you know, I'll go and teach at my adjunct job for 4 to 5 hours, and I'll come back and I'll be too tired, so I'll practice for 30 minutes and I'll have a short day that day, but I'll sort of narrow in on what really needs my attention. Maybe it's the second theme of the first movement in this piece, for example. Or maybe I just want to sight read through the Beethoven sonata that I'm performing on an upcoming recital or something like that, just to sort of keep everything fresh, keep my musical juices flowing. But a great day for me looks like waking up somewhere around 9 o'clock. I'm kind of a late riser. Maybe 9:30, even if I haven't slept very well. And then I have a little bit to eat, a little bit of caffeine, and I probably start practicing around 10:15. And I'll practice for 2 hours, take a break, go for a run, go for a swim, come back, have a little bit of lunch, practice for another 2 hours, and in between that time, sort of take a 5-minute break. And then if I can do that 3 times a day and intersperse with either physical activity or reading for a class or, you know, starting to work on a paper, then that's always a really good day. A bad day for me is generally Fridays because I teach for 10 hours.
Ooh.
It's rough. Ooh. And I don't have a lunch break, so my students are always, the last students of the day are just like, oh God, what are we doing today? And then I come home and I generally just sit on the couch and watch an episode of whatever terrible TV show I'm on now, and then that's the end of the day, and I ring in the weekend with that kind of a Friday. So, but after having worked really hard for the entire week, I sort of allow myself that kind of some time off. So,
during your practice time and some of the repertoire you have mentioned, it's all about piano etudes, the ballads, piano solo works, mm-hmm. and suddenly you find yourself in the midst of an orchestra, and you're playing now not by yourself, but you are playing with 70 people all together. So what sort of adjustments you have to make in your playing in order to keep the musicality and the fluidity, but at the same time being able to communicate and in many ways lead the orchestra yourself from the piano?
You know, I've played with the orchestra a few times, and I think the hardest thing for me is to actually remember that I'm the soloist. And part of that is that I 60% of what I do in performance is actually collaboration. I have about 5 active duos that I play in. I'm in a saxophone and piano duo, violin and piano duo, viola and piano duo. I play with singers in an art song group that's actually based in Boston. So, and I love playing with people. And part of it is that it is just a different approach. It's a little bit like playing with orchestra in many ways, is that there's that element, whether it's 70 people or one person or 5 people, there's that element of collaboration that I really, really am hungry for in my career. I love that. But for a pianist, I'm somebody who is, I'm pretty sensitive and very accommodating. And, you know, I've actually had the comment from people saying that I play too much like an accompanist, which is not a good thing to hear, actually. Generally, people don't mean it as a compliment. And what they mean is that I'm turning over the soloist role to the other person or to the other people too much. So the challenge for me in playing with orchestra is actually trying to lead as much as I can and not following what's going on behind me. But there's always a happy medium, of course, because if in rehearsal, for example, the bassoon player takes a little bit of time in their solo, I can't say, well, no, that's not how I want to do it, because then we start to pull apart. So it's an adventure in many ways, because it really is just constant dialogue. I think what's interesting, actually, is that it makes me a better pianist, because, you know, when I'm creating an interpretation, when I'm working on the creative process of building a piece from the ground up in terms of how I approach it, I record myself a lot. And the reactions I often have are to tempo, the tempi that I choose in a performance, or to the way I structure a phrase. And often my reaction to my own playing is that it doesn't sound in time enough, or I think that I'm doing something where I'm I'm using rubato and I'm being very expressive, but in the recording it sounds contrived. And I think what's interesting about the experience we've had working together is that in order to keep everybody together, I have to be all the more clear with subdivisions or with the way that I'm articulating active 16th notes. And in the end, I think it makes the piece sound a lot better. I think it makes me sound like more in control. And at the same time, it's serving the orchestra, because they can hear where the beats are and how I'm structuring the phrase. So I've taken a lot away from it, not only right now, but in past experiences, because I think really in that collaboration and in the what some might call a sacrifice that you're making, but what is really just sort of the scotch tape that keeps everything together, it turns out that it enhances the music more. So.
What do you do in your spare time? What do you do for fun?
What is spare time? No, I'm just kidding. What do I do for fun? It kind of always evolves. I'm always looking for new things. You know, Franz Liszt said that, these are words to live by. I have not gotten to the point where I can live by them yet. But Franz Liszt said that you should have all of your practice done before, I think he said 10 a.m., but maybe noon. Maybe he said noon. Let's just go with noon. That's more reasonable for me. And then the rest of the day you should spend walking and reading. And I don't think I've had a single day when I've ever gotten to do that. But, I mean, music is fun for me. So I do non-school related things that are musical and fun. Like I'll go to sight reading parties with friends, chamber music parties. But when it's not music related, I love to swim. I've gotten really into swimming lately. And the great thing about that is that I can be underwater and just feel like all of the muscles that I've been pulling on and pushing on all day long at the piano are just like relaxed, which is great. You should try it. So I try to move my body in other ways besides this, because that gets a little tiring. I do like to read, but I'm not a very good reader. I'm not a consistent reader. I do have my, you know, favorite TV shows, just like everybody, that I like to kick back and watch. I never used to like cats until I adopted Felix and Fanny Mendelssohn, who are my brother and sister cats. And they are just about my favorite creatures in the entire world, so I do like to play with them and snuggle them. That is very relaxing for me. And, you know, getting together with musical friends and non-musical friends and talking about generally music, even with a non-musical friends, is a way to sort of, you know, as musicians, we're always doing something that is enhancing what we do at the instrument, and I tried to push that away for a long time, and then I realized that that's just really not. When you're passionate about what you do, everything contributes to it. So I find that more often than not, I can go an entire 24-hour day where I haven't really taken a break, but it doesn't feel like, I don't feel tired of it. So, and I hope that that continues forever, because we don't really get to retire, so, you know. But, you know, I try to relax when I can.
Well, thank you very much for being here. It's a pleasure working with you. I'm really looking forward to the concert.
I can't wait. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. you.